I remember I was a junior in high school at Penn High School. I did go to the high school that I teach at now, which is an interesting day. But my mother came home and she talked about my next year's schedule. She had just talked to my guidance counselor. And she said, "Alan, you're going to take speech class next year." Now, I'm a very shy person. So when I heard my mother say, "I have to take speech class, where I have to get up in front of 30 or 40 people and talk," my heart just dropped out. That's hard for a shy person. But I also knew if Marjorie Rhodes said, "You're taking speech class next year," you were taking speech class next year. And I guess my mother wouldn't have made a very good NFL player, so I didn't argue at all when she told me that. But talking to the high school guys especially, that for the past 45 years or so, I made my living by getting up in front of 30 or 40 people and talking and going through whatever it is that I was going to talk about. So I'll try to do my best. I think that I've got a tough audience here, meaning I kind of glanced at everybody here, the roles that you have, and I've got, you know, varsity coaches here, middle school coaches, and coaches that are just coaching in the league, do other things, and have a real life, besides being just a basketball coach. But you're investing time, maybe because your son or daughter wants to play and nobody else will do it. Maybe because you really love basketball and it's an opportunity for you to be involved with basketball. But I'm going to share a few ideas, and then from there, I kind of want to go wherever you would like to go to wrap up tonight. If you came here for a press breaker, I'll give you my best press breaker. And I know in the league we don't have zones, but if you're also playing at speech somewhere, maybe you need a zone press breaker, depending on where the different groups are playing. My idea of a basketball program would be this. And I don't know what your role is, but basically, my vision for a high school situation, there's a head coach. And that coach is usually told that he's in charge of the basketball program by all of the administrators. Until you want to do something. And then you find out you've got lots of responsibility, but very little power, perhaps, to really do something. So your ability to work with people is indeed a huge thing as a head coach. After that, I don't care. Every one of my other coaches, I try to make sure they understand. I don't care if you win zero games, as long as you build varsity basketball players. I'm not going to fire you, JV coach, freshman coach, eighth grade coach, 7th grade coach, 6th grade coach, because of wins and losses. All I care about is, I've got this idea in my head of a basketball program. And again, everybody, there's many correct ways to play basketball. But in a given program, I think everybody should do their best to follow the head coach's vision. If that vision isn't successful, he or she's the one that's going to be fired. Don't you be responsible for somebody else getting fired? You don't want to do that work somewhere. So don't do it in your role as a coach or part of the feeder program. head coaches, middle school coaches, I can send you my entire basketball curriculum. I didn't bring it and hand it out because I thought that was presumptuous, meaning I want you, if you're not the head coach somewhere, to really work at finding out what your head coach wants. And you might say, well, wait a minute, Coach Rhodes, wait a minute, shouldn't my head coach tell me what he wants? Well, yes and no, in my opinion, because I made a living in a tough state for basketball, Indiana. And I've had an awful lot of friends that have been fired as basketball coaches. And usually the mistake that they made was not understanding that a basketball program, you first have to establish credibility with the varsity team. Junior varsity team. Freshman team. I haven't gone to that many schools. But Logansport, originally at Warsaw, and now at Penn, in my first couple of years, my only thought, truly, is going to be find a varsity assistant who can help me, and find a JV coach who will try to do what I want. And that's it. Very little work with the freshman team. Very little work, especially the middle school team. Yes, I'll give a skeleton program. But without credibility at the varsity level, without showing, I'm not saying winning, showing progress, it's really hard to get a seventh grade coach maybe to really buy into your system. A program has to be built from the top down, and like I said, yes, my first year, I get the seventh grade coaches at Penn. Here's what I want you to teach. I never try to judge whether they taught them or not. I was too busy because the varsity team was losing, and I was on my way out the door. Because they're used to winning at Penn. And so, I had to stay right there. You know, I've had an unusual career this way too. Long time ago, my first year at Warsaw, we had an excellent team. We went to the Final Four in Indiana in the old system. My first year as a coach. I was the smartest guy in the world. Now the next year, we only won four games. So I went from the smartest guy in the world to the dumbest guy in the world. Literally, two-thirds of the way through that season, the coach ahead of me had established a Sunday morning breakfast for the Brewster Club and the coach. About two-thirds of the way through my second season, there I was. The Brewster Club had canceled the meeting, but nobody had bothered to call me. I got to the place where I was going to talk about. We lost another game last night, here's why. I had my whole speech, stayed up late. Nobody is there. Had a room that they resolved. I went in, and I walked in the room, and I gave my speech to an empty room. The waitresses thought I was crazy. But I had agreed every Sunday morning that I was going to go talking about my team. After about a half an hour, there weren't any questions, because nobody was there. So, a coach, that's kind of an unusual stuff. But through it all, by finding loyal people, I think eventually we built Warsaw into a very fine basketball program. I really believe that Logansport, we did excellent things. At Northrop, I was there 1 year. Barry Coolman has done great things since. And at Penn, I really feel like we've made progress. Now, I'm heading into my seventh year. 2 years ago, remember those seventh and eighth grade coaches that I didn't bother the first 2 years? I had to fire three of them. our evaluator. You can't tell us what to do.
Okay.
But fortunately, I have a good superintendent. And he understands what a program is about. And so, they should have had fire. In my opinion, anybody with quality that's part of the program either follows the top or they should quit. I tell them that all the time. If you can't do what I want, you should quit. And I'm sharing that with you because, like I said, if you're a seventh grade coach and you can't do what the head coach wants, then have honor and quit is what I would recommend. Don't backstab the head coach. Don't do it your own way. If the head coach wants you to play all man for man, nothing else, do it. If the head coach wants you to play 2-3 zone, nothing but 2-3 zone, do it. Now, by the same token, you might not be able to find out what the head coach wants. That's where, because, like I said, depending on how long the head coach has been there, if he or she is smart, they're working their way down. And especially, they might not be to a fourth grade team playing in Coach Cummings' league. They might not be reaching out to you, but I'm sure they'd be happy to help you. They just have to know that you want help. So reach out to the coaching staff at the high school. Might not even be there. And find out what they want you to do. I guarantee you, if you go to them and say, Coach, what do you want us to do? They'll help. I just guarantee you that they'll help. And that's what the program's about. I've got things that I want a fifth grader to be able to do. Now, there's different components to that. There's individual components. And there's also team components. There's offensive components, defensive components, and rebounding components. When I talk basketball, I always separate those three things. Offense, rebounding, defense. Because when you think about basketball, those young guys, smart enough, they're from Angola, right? I lived in Angola for 7 years. My first high school coaching job was junior varsity coach at Angola High School. Now, I'm going to ask you a question in a minute. Here's basketball, guys. You're on offense. Somebody shoots, then there's rebounding. Then you're on defense. And then the other team shoots and there's rebounding. And then you're on offense, then there's rebounding. Then you're on defense, then there's rebounding. I just named 8 things. How many of those was rebounding? 4! I love those Angola Hornets. They're smart. I'm not the best math teacher in the world. I am a math teacher. 4 out of 8. When we write that as a fraction and reduce it, what would it be? 1/2. So first of all, you want to win basketball games, half of basketball is rebounding. You want to win more games? Half of basketball is rebounding. So yeah, you've got to work on offense. You've got to work on defense. But you better be able to rebound. My 2 sons are very big. I have 2 sons. Talking about, I coached one of them in basketball. The other one, when he was in 8th grade, told me, Coach, Dad, I don't like basketball. I don't want to play. He was a decent player. But my philosophy on that, a parent should help the kid any way they want to do something. My wife Kathy and I, we watched the boys. If they had an interest, we tried to find somebody who could help them. Karate. Second son's a black belt in karate. If he had an interest in karate, I would have found somebody who could teach him. By the way, that's good for basketball parents, too. When you're the parent, be in the role of the parent. Once they get to this, especially the varsity level, let the coach coach them. And at home, just give them a lifesaver, or whatever those commercials, or a Coca-Cola, or something. Neither here nor there, and my son, Chris, part of an excellent basketball team, a Final Four team in 2000. Great part of the team. Could have been a great player, he chose to be a good player. At home, though, never mentioned basketball. I walk in, he's laying on the couch. I know he hasn't done his the workout that day. I say nothing, because I didn't know if his teammates had done their individual workout. So my philosophy was a little more his choice. Destiny's a matter of choice. He didn't want to be great. He chose to be good. I live with that. He knows more basketball than most people, and above all, we're great friends today. He's 32 years old. I didn't let basketball screw up our relationship. He needed a dad, like Kim said. That's an ongoing problem. My other son didn't care about basketball. I helped him pursue other things. By the way, sometimes you think you're helping people by helping them get a college scholarship or anything else. Much more important than that, this is you're helping them grow up the right way. My second son, Curtis, who didn't play basketball, knows all the lessons of my basketball camp better than any player that I've ever coached. He pursues excellence in everything that he did. When he got there from high school, they gave him a little scholarship to go to the college anywhere free. He was valedictorian at Rose Holman. He was first division in band. When he got out of Rose Holman, he went and did top secret government works for 7 years. He kept all of us safe. Put computers into airplanes. He quit that job, making more money than I will ever see. And now he's getting his doctorate at Notre Dame. That's what my basketball camp did. Talent plus attitude plus skill equals whatever you want to be. So, I'm trying to hit the different roles here. Now, if we were just the Penn High School basketball program, and by the way, we started, I think, three teams in Luke's league over Holy Cross and Plymouth, this year I hope to have more, I'm not sure. But after 7 years, I'm finally working with sixth grade coaches. We don't have any sixth grade teams in the school. We don't like basketball well enough. We cut them out a long time ago. No fourth grade teams, no fifth grade teams. So if I want to have a true basketball program, I better go to parents. I better reach out and I better figure it out. And we're just on the edge of starting that. But as you came in here tonight, and you thought about basketball, what X's and O's, what is something that would help you with your fourth grade team, fifth grade team, sixth grade team, seventh grade team, eighth grade team, ninth grade team, junior varsity team, varsity team? Is there anything that we could talk about that would help you? I know you're not used to talking, but my goal is to help you. Is there any aspect of basketball that you would like to hear my thoughts on? Or do we always put it on? Anything? You guys seem close.
Coach, rebounding 50% of the show is part of the work on.
Okay. If we talk about rebounding. And look. Have your kids, varsity kids, I hate watching my varsity kids play one-on-one. Because they're so bad. And that brings up a huge problem. The problem with basketball in the United States is they play too many games. And they don't practice enough. They don't practice the right way enough. Let's go play 50 games in space. Let's go here, there, and everywhere. Let's drive all over. You know, sometimes I sit down with a kid who's not going to be a college basketball player, but he thinks he has to play AAU. And I say, all right, Friday you left Penn High School. You drove 4 hours to the tournament. You are the ninth guy on the team. You played 3 minutes in 4 games. So that's 12 minutes you play. How many times did you shoot? 3, coach. Okay? And this is how you're choosing to make our team better? You think 3 shots in 12 minutes of play, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, is the way that you get better as a basketball player? I tell you what, let's take 15 minutes and see how many shots you can get here. Now let's multiply that number of shots for 15 minutes that you just did times 3 days that you sat on the bench on your AAU team. Also bringing out a point, if you are coaching younger teams, play everybody. If they're on the team, you should get to play. In feeder situations. It's hard to convince coaches of that. In 7th and 8th grade, at Warsaw, we use the number system. So 7th grade coach, here's your number system. In the first quarter, you play 1, 2, 3, 9, and 10. By how good basketball players are. In the next quarter, you play 4, 5, 6, and like that. That way, there was a system where everybody got to play, everybody developed. So when that best kid quit and concentrated on football, the others had a lot of play. But rebound. Give me two guys that want to play one-on-one. Not just two, and you only need one ball for one-on-one. He says, what?
Simple! What a simple game!
three dribble limit. I'm kidding. But in other words, in a game, you're not just going to dribble around. You're going to get something else. Another idea for helping young kids, make the free throw lane out of bounds. Here, you're going down to the restroom.
Not to the basket area.
Hey, you're supposed to be going to the basket area with the ball.
Ball
take one dribble to your strong side, and you're going to shoot the ball. Okay?
Now, offensive rebounding,
coaches.
You hear close up the mic, coach.
Put him on back. He's guard here. Face him, face the ball. Don't face him, don't play on the line. Just face him. When people post up, don't have them on the line, have them face the ball. They want to be facing the ball. So now, your job of offensive rebounding is this entire side. Because as soon as he shoots, you're going to spin like this. That guy's behind you. Anything that comes off your way, you should be able to put back in. He's got to be running, otherwise you wouldn't shot. You would have thrown the ball. Everybody see what I'm trying to teach him? Okay? If they run, that gives away offensive rebounding position to the offensive center if he shoots. Now,
over here, move on.
All right. Coaches, what I want, low man here, I want him to go in underneath and then come back and just think of a line right here. I want the first spot. He's now in the second spot. And then there's going to be a third spot and a fourth spot. Okay? Who's along?
You're a little player.
Okay. So when he shoots, here's what people do. They go this way, and they go to that middle spot. And then the ball bounces off, and the other team goes and dumps it, if you're watching NBA preseason right now. So the thing that I'm showing you that is put food on my table is we want that third spot. People don't know how to rebound from the wing. Thanks, bro. front. Should it? If you can't tell it to him, it helps to have a really good player like your daughter shoot it too. Then the rebounding doesn't matter near as much.
You do one more time, yes, guys. The one time. Here we go.
I practice every day for 7 years, so you can't tell me it can't be done.
I practice every day for 7 years straight. Every day, 7 days a week for 7 years.
Might be an hour,
might be 4 hours. The main thing is, getting this through 5 hours straight, you do this a bit long. So it might be 45 minutes in the morning, 45 minutes in the day, 45 minutes in the night. Whatever works for you. But there's obviously things done there. I can't do it. I'm too busy. Yeah, you're in fourth grade and you're too busy. Too busy.